tonight, the entire Philippines again considered as high risk for COVID-19.
The delivery of much-needed cash aid to Metro Manila's quarantined residents delayed for another day.
Philippine President Duterte pledges rewards for Filipino boxing medalists on their return from the Tokyo Olympics.
And Afghan government forces kill more than a dozen Taliban fighters.
I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Karen Davila.
On our broadcast tonight, the Philippines at high risk once more for COVID-19. The country's risk classification is raised as cases of the highly transmissible Delta variant are detected in over half of the country's regions. Rafael Bozano has tonight's top story.
The Philippines' classification for COVID-19 is now high risk. This after recording a positive two-week growth rate and high average daily attack rate. While different regions in the country have different risk classifications, the Capital Region, Cordillera Administrative Region, Regions 1, 2, 4A, 7, and 10 are now also high risk. 13 regions in the country have now seen a case of the more contagious Delta variant. In the Capital Region, 13 areas have recorded the same. For the Okta Research Group, the possibility of the Delta variant replacing the dominant Alpha and Beta variants is not far-fetched. It adds, this would also explain the steady increase of the reproduction number. Alert Level 4 has been hoisted in 10 areas in Metro Manila, the remainder of which are under the second highest Alert Level 3. The DOH explains the alert levels are in no way replacements for the quarantine classifications. Metro Manila is under the most stringent enhanced community quarantine until the 20th of August.
We still look at the same metrics and processes in determining our quarantine classification. This alert level is an early warning system that is action targeted beyond what is recommended for quarantine classification. This also allows immediate feedback on actions done by the national, the regional, and the local government units.
But even if restrictions were to ease after the ECQ, the possibility of recording more cases remains. Despite this, the DOH reiterated there is no surge or even a third wave of infections.
Kahit na atin pong hinihigpitan ang ating mga pinapatupad na mga protocols, maaring patuloy pa rin tumaas sa mga kaso. Pero ang atin pong objective sa ngayon, alam natin that that will happen, no? That might happen. Ang atin pong objective is to reduce the number of those being hospitalized and dying. Yan po yung major objective ng ating gobyerno.
The increase in COVID-19 cases in the country was observed among all age groups. Comparing data from August 1 and August 8, the highest increase within a week was recorded among those between the ages of 20 to 44 years, the working population. Monday's tally saw 8,900 new COVID-19 infections, 7,937 recoveries, and 6 deaths. The DOH notes the low case count is affected by the low laboratory output over the weekend. While the country's healthcare utilization rate is at a manageable 54.7%, the DOH admits some hospitals are now experiencing difficulties as infections increase. St. Luke's Medical Center announced its COVID-19 wards and critical care units in both Global City and Quezon City have already reached full capacity. It adds more patients are awaiting admissions at the emergency rooms. At the Amang Rodriguez Memorial Medical Center in Marikina City, the number of patients has now doubled. Many of the patients in critical condition are unvaccinated. In San Fernando, Pampanga, the number of patients has also risen. Hospitals in the area are now full. In Ilocos Norte, the Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital and Medical Center is experiencing a lack of health workers after the virus infected 159 staff members.
Wala na akong face-to-face, at least for 3 departments lang naman po. Yung ibang departments, tuloy pa rin ho. ang OPD nila. Tuloy-tuloy ho ang hiring namin sa nursing.
Okay.
Pero yung mga doktor ho, mahirap.
Oo nga.
Konti lang ang doktor dun sa Ilocos.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Metro Manila's local governments are preparing their own methods to distribute cash aid to residents under lockdown since Friday. In the meantime, some help is already being given in the form of food packs. Pia Gutierrez reports.
Local government units in Metro Manila are set to start this week the distribution of financial aid to almost 11 million Filipinos affected by the implementation of the enhanced community quarantine. A total of 10.9 billion pesos have been allocated for cash assistance, or 1,000 pesos per individual with a maximum 4,000 pesos per family. Quezon City resident Eileen says she will try to make sure the money will last for the entire lockdown period.
Kung dumating man po yun, unang po namin bibilhin ko yun, pagkain po namin dito sa bahay. Siguro po, hindi naman po siguro sapat, kailangan pong pagkasyahin. Unang-una may mga estudyante po ako. Tatlo po estudyante ko. Tapos, wala mo naman po tayo magawa kundi pagkasyan po.
Some LGUs, however, have started distributing food packs. The Muntinlupa LGU on Monday gave families relief packs. The Pasay LGU also distributed about 5 kilos of rice per family in 4 barangays. About 25,000 fully vaccinated senior citizens in Makati City received gift certificates worth 1,000 pesos, while the Pasig LGU set aside about 260,000 food packs for distribution. The DILG says it is up to local government authorities to come up with their own efficient distribution systems to avoid crowding in payout sites. The Makati Muntinlupa LGUs have announced that cash aid will be distributed online, while Pasig City will be setting up smaller distribution sites to prevent long lines.
We will break it down almost street per street ang mangyayari to just make sure that they are small and manageable, and our goal is to minimize the lines. So ibig sabihin dapat ilang tao lang ang nakapila at any given time.
The Quezon City LGU meanwhile says they have already put in place measures to ensure social distancing in distribution centers.
Yung venue, kung gaano kalaki ang venue, kung ilan bawat batch ang pupunta, kung gaano kalayo yung distancing ng mga upuan, at dapat talaga nakaupo lahat ng tao, kung ano yung mga patakaran na dapat natin iisipin, no? Halimbawa, per batch ba ito, separate times na ibibigay, ibang mga details, bahala na si Kapitan.
Belmonte says they have also asked the Philippine National Police to assist in crowd control. Meanwhile, some Metro Manila mayors are planning to ask the DILG to extend the 15-day deadline for the distribution of ECQ aid.
Kung pwede daw po silang mag-request ng extension. At pumayag naman po si Secretary Eduardo Anyo at si Secretary Rolly Bautista ng extension.
Malacanang assured the provinces of Laguna and Bataan they will also receive financial assistance. The government is allocating some 2.7 billion pesos for Laguna, while officials are finalizing the allotment for Bataan. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Pandemic Task Force is considering the inclusion of children in the country's COVID vaccination program. One senior official says COVID jabs could be given to kids towards the end of next month. More from Vivian Gulia.
As more children contract COVID-19 in the Philippines, some local officials urge the national government to open the COVID vaccination to minors.
Sa 70 below ang percentage namin dito ay halos mga nasa 30%. Napakalaki. Paano alagaan ng isang bata kung merong siyang COVID, at lalo na kung Delta variant? Sigurado mahahawa at magkakaroon din ng COVID yung matanda o magulang na mag-aalaga sa kanya.
Health Secretary Francisco Duque supports vaccinating minors against COVID, but he stresses this can only be done if there is enough supply.
Supply permitting, I wouldn't mind that we should already start vaccinating children for as long as first we prioritize which among the children. Those with comorbidities, of course, let's vaccinate them.
The National Task Force Against COVID-19 laid down the proposal to the National Immunization Technical Advisory Group and local experts who are now studying it.
We need to know siguro kung sino sa pediatric population at risk of severe infection.
So not all pediatric, but probably, siguro magpa-focus doon sa may mga comorbidities, no? But the 12 to 17.
Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. says the government is negotiating to acquire around 26 million COVID vaccine doses for the country's pediatric inoculation. But he sees the rollout happening likely by end of September or October.
Once that we have already enough supply of those and of those vaccines, we can start for as long as the expert already allowed us to use these vaccines for the 12 years and above and maybe 3 years and above later.
So far, only Pfizer's COVID jab has an emergency use authorization in the Philippines for children 12 to 17 years old. The Food and Drug Administration says vaccine experts are still evaluating Sinovac's application to expand its EUA to minors 3 to 17 years old.
It's still under evaluation, no? Kasi kulang pa tayo sa, dun sa data. In fact, talagang ganito yan, no? Pag sa bata na kasi ang pag-usapan, 3 years old to 17, especially the less than 12 years old. Kailangan talagang pag-aralan yan ng mabuti, na maigi. Dahil hindi pa natin alam kung ano ang mga adverse event. Kasi yung sa mga bata kasi ang sinubmit lang na data is the phase 1 and phase 2. So walang phase 3 studies on that. Ha? So walang actual clinical trial na phase 3.
Only close to 11.4 million individuals or 10.3% of the country's population have been fully vaccinated, while over 13 million are partially vaccinated. The government's goal is to inoculate 70 million Filipinos this year. Asked about the government's program to entice those unwilling to get vaccinated, Malacanang has this to say.
Eh, bahala na si COVID-19 sa kanila kung ayaw nila magpabakuna.
In Marikina City, the number of vaccine registrants online has more than doubled at around 5,000 to 8,000 daily. The local government has increased its daily first dose jabbing target to 15,000 from the previous 10,000.
Nakita rin natin yung dating problema ng vaccine hesitancy. Ngayon ay vaccine rush. Maraming nagmamadali at maraming gusto na makapagpabakuna.
Makati City also raised its daily COVID vaccination target from 5,000 to 7,000. Senior citizens are allowed to walk in without an appointment.
Meron kami mga pre-registered na mga seniors na kahit walang schedule, pinapawalk-in na namin dun sa mga sites namin. Pero yun niya, pinipilit pa rin namin na meron social distancing, na hindi magkagulo yung mga tao at hindi rin magsiksikan.
In Northern Metro Manila, 12 out of the 30 churches under the Caloocan Diocese have been approved by Bishop Ambo David to serve as vaccination hubs for residents in Caloocan, Malabon, and Navota City. And in Manila, 24/7 COVID vaccinations continue, but the city no longer allows walk-ins after thousands crowded its vaccination sites last week. The palace denies it was President Duterte's recent pronouncement that spurred chaos in vaccination sites. President Duterte earlier ordered barangay officials and the police to escort unvaccinated people back to their homes if they insist on going outside.
Yung pag-uunahan po, Thursday na po yon. Lunes po na nagsalita ang Presidente. Kung talagang reaction po yan sa sinabi ni Presidente, dapat po yan ay nagsiksika na Tuesday pa lang o Wednesday. No? Pero hindi po nangyari yun. No? Wala po kami sinisisi, ha? Pero yung mga lokal na pamahalaan, huwag naman kayo magbabaling ng pula sa ating presidente. Dahil the bottom line is, katungkulan nyo pa rin na kayo magpatupad ng maayos at makataong pagbabakunahan.
Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The second day of Metro Manila's lockdown, marred by the killing of an alleged curfew violator. CCTV footage taken Saturday shows a village watchman in Manila as he confronted the victim before shooting him in the back. The watchman was identified as Cesar Panlaki. He's now in police custody and he's been charged with murder. His still unidentified victim was said to be mentally ill.
Biktima at yung suspect natin ay nagkaroon ng verbal confrontation kung saan nga tinangka nitong biktima na paluin itong ating tanod. Pero nalaman nga natin itong biktima na ito ay may problema sa pag-iisip.
Philippine Senate President Tito Soto disappointed with the outright rejection by Vice President Lenny Robredo of the so-called unification plan of Senator Pamphilo Lacson. Soto says Robredo should have studied all possibilities first before she made her decision. Soto now believes Robredo and her people may have already formed their plans for next year's presidential race. Lacson had proposed that opposition presidential aspirants should give way to the candidate with the highest survey rating. But political science professor Clarita Carlos insists surveys are not the only factors that potential candidates should consider.
Parang ang nagde-decide ng who is going to run where is surveys. Why is this happening?
Survey. No? The survey.
This is most correct. Absurd and brainless, if I may say so. No? So, bakit yung survey ang ano ang kabayo mo? Ay, yan lang ay nandiyan lang sa tabi-tabi.
The Philippines' victorious boxing Olympians are back from the Tokyo Games. President Duterte congratulated them during a virtual meeting. He pledged a 2 million peso cash incentive each for silver medalists Nesty Petesho and Carlo Paalam. The president also promised to give bronze medalist Yumir Marshall 1 million pesos. Boxer Irish Magno came home without a medal but will receive 200,000 pesos from the office of the president.
It is not an everyday occurrence that we receive such an honor from our citizens of the Republic of the Philippines. Those who participated in all events brought honor to the country, irrespective of I do not care about winning, and that is why they will receive the 200,000 pesos. All of you, all other Olympians will receive from my office.
The boxer's homecoming was overshadowed by controversial remarks of President Duterte's spokesman. Harry Roque claims the outstanding Olympic performance of the Philippines is due to the administration's financial support for Filipino athletes.
Hindi coincidence na we had the best ever performance in the Olympics, including our first gold medal ever in our history, in under the leadership of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. The figures will bear me out, pero talaga naman pong nagtanim at nag-invest ang ating Pangulo sa ating mga atleta. Kauna-unang panahon po, record po ang suportang pinansyal na ibinigay natin sa ating mga atleta.
But Philippine Olympic Committee head Abraham Tolentino pointed out in a radio interview that they had to practically beg for funds from the government and the private sector for the training of athletes. This year's Philippine gold medalist, weightlifter Heidelin Diaz, had to endure online bashing in mid-2019 after she tweeted on social media to get funding support for her training.
Well, those days of pleading for support certainly now far behind Heidelin Diaz. The champion weightlifter set foot in her new fully furnished condominium unit in Quezon City. The 14 million peso unit is a gift from business tycoon Andrew Tan and property giant Mega World. It's just one of scores of rewards Diaz has received after her historic Tokyo Olympic victory. But despite her Olympic windfall, Diaz is urging other Filipino athletes not to make rewards and incentives as their motivation to excel in their sports.
Mas okay yung ginagawa nyo dahil mahal nyo yung ginagawa nyo at mahal nyo yung Pilipinas. Kasi kung mahal yung ginagawa nyo, every day you will do your best. Kahit medyo mahirap, medyo gusto mo nang sumuko, ang hirap na pinagdaanan nyo or maraming challenges and trials, ang daming nagbabash or trolls.
Up next, the United Nations issues its gravest warning yet on global warming.
Also later, more than a dozen Taliban fighters killed in Afghanistan. The World Tonight returns after the break.
We're back on The World Tonight. Global warming dangerously close to being out of control. The UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere are high enough to guarantee climate disruption for decades. This means deadly heat waves, hurricanes, and other extreme weather conditions across the globe will only become more severe. The report also concludes humans have caused the climate crisis. It urges nations to implement a large-scale reduction of greenhouse gas emissions to address this crisis. Leaders from nearly 200 countries will meet in Glasgow this November for a major climate conference.
Afghan forces kill more than a dozen Taliban insurgents in Kandahar province. Afghanistan's defense ministry posted on social media a video of its airstrikes in the province. Taliban fighters overran three provincial capitals and continues to attack more cities. But the interior ministry said defense forces are repelling them.
America's top infectious diseases expert warns vaccine hesitancy could lead to COVID-19 mutations worse than the Delta variant. The details of that story and other global COVID updates in this report.
Recent studies that Dr. Anthony Fauci, director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases in the U.S., warns that vaccine hesitancy could lead to the development of COVID variants that may be resistant to the current crop of vaccines.
The vaccines do quite well against Delta, particularly in protecting you from severe disease. But if you give the virus a chance to continue to change, you're leading to a vulnerability that we might get a worse variant, and then that will impact not only the unvaccinated, that will impact the vaccinated, because that variant could evade the protection of the vaccine.
The United States has reported more than 100,000 new cases a day on average for the past 2 days. Canada opens its border with the U.S. for vaccinated Americans as well as returning permanent residents. The border has been closed to non-essential travel since March last year. Australia's most populous state of New South Wales expands its COVID-19 lockdown to the rural town of Tamworth. This is due to concerns the virus may have spread from Sydney into the countryside. New South Wales reported 283 locally acquired COVID cases in the past 24 hours. The extended lockdown in New South Wales threatens to drive the country's economy into its second recession in as many years. Australia's drug regulator, meanwhile, has also granted provisional approval to Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine. The first 1 million doses of the Moderna vaccine will arrive in September. A total of 10 million doses are arriving this year.
Today, we have been given the green light to take another very important step forward to implement our national plan on the path forward out of COVID-19. The Therapeutic Goods Administration has given provisional approval for the use of Moderna for Australians aged 18 years and over.
Philippine shares break a two-day losing streak as investors cheer an upward revision in the country's first quarter GDP print. Rain Muski reports.
Philippine shares soar 1.4%, besting Asian peers for the day. The main index broke through the 6,600 resistance. Value turnover was respectable despite a second session of foreign fund selling. Regina Capital Development Corporation says investors have been buying stocks ahead of the potential bounce in economic growth in the second quarter of the year. As for Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities, he attributes the rally to the upward revision of the country's first quarter GDP figure.
The catalyst today was really the news that we had a preview of what sort of GDP numbers to look forward to in tomorrow's report. The news was the revision of the first quarter contraction from 4.2%, as you mentioned, to just 3.9%. And the series of second quarter corporate earnings results that have come out are obviously much better because of the lower base. So all of these provided a positive backdrop for tomorrow's announcement of the GDP results.
As long as the second quarter growth data is not lower than 10%, Vistan says the market may see the main index surge back to the 6,800 level. April Lee Tan of COL Financial agrees and expects the Philippine Central Bank to keep interest rates unchanged at its policy setting meeting on Thursday. Still, she says there's a reason to be cautious.
Well, it's quite unfortunate that we're in a period of no interest. You know, a lot of cautiousness because, you know, the economy is recovering, but it's not something that you would really be excited about. That's why there is no urgency in buying. And of course, we now have this lockdown, which is another downside risk for earnings. I think investors want to have a, you know, better idea of how things will turn out before they will have a stronger conviction. But we are recommending investors to take advantage of the depressed prices of stocks to start coming in and start accumulating.
For the day, the mining and oil index fell 1.8% after sharp falls in gold and oil prices spooked sentiment across Asia. Meanwhile, the stock price of Kep Wealth Property Philippines plunged 10% after reporting profits also plummeting 95% in the second quarter. Its shares are now worth less than its 2019 IPO price of 5 pesos and 74 centavos per share. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Albert Einstein. The only thing more dangerous than ignorance is arrogance.
And that is The World Tonight, the 9th of August, 2021. I'm Karen Davila.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.